Okay, good morning, everybody, and happy Easter to everybody who's joined us here this morning. This morning, we're going to remember our Lord Jesus' death on the cross when we take the communion. And we're also going to celebrate the Lord Jesus' resurrection during our service. But before we start, we're going to have a hymn, which is called The Power of the Cross. Lord and Heavenly Father, we come this morning before you to praise, to thank you for the power of the cross. Lord, we thank you that for your love for each one of us, your care and your understanding. And Lord, we thank you that you were prepared to come to this earth to become our sacrifice for our sins. Lord, we thank you that you were prepared to go all the way to the cross of Calvary for us. And Lord, we remember this. We remember your death, how that you took our punishment there on the cross, and your death on that cross of Calvary. And Lord, we also celebrate the fact that on the third day you conquered sin and that you rose again. And Lord, we thank you for this. We thank you that we can live victorious lives, knowing that we are saved and that we have been welcomed into your family. Lord, we thank you for all these things. And we thank you for the message of Easter that tells us so clearly what you have done for us. Amen. Okay, let's go on to the notices. The notices for this week is that on Wednesday, there is no meeting. We've been alternating between Rock Solid and a Zoom fellowship, but this Wednesday, there's not going to be a Zoom fellowship or the Rock Solid. Next Sunday, the family service will be taken by Morris on Zoom. But I want to give you advance notice that on the 18th of June, which is going to be in a fortnight's time, the church is going to be reopened. So we'll be taking our services from the church. So that's just an advance notice, and you'll hear a lot more about it next week. Okay, let's have let's start with this. Three significant Christian holy days. There are lots of holy days in the Christian calendar, lots and lots of them. But I've chosen the three which I think are the most important days of the Christian calendar. I've chosen Christmas Day, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. Now, there are lots. Obviously, last week it was Palm Sunday. In a few weeks' time, it'll be Pentecost or Ascension Day. We've gone through Maundy Thursday, Shrove Tuesday, which was the first day of Lent, and Pancake Day. So there's lots and lots of days in the Christian calendar. But I've chosen these three. Now, if I was to choose four, I'd probably include Pentecost. Or if it was five, I'd probably include Palm Sunday. But these three are the ones that I consider or think, and this is only my personal view, are the three most significant and the most important. Now, if I was to choose one, which one would it be? Now, I know that the world, when I say the world, I mean outside the church, within the church, it'd be Christmas Day. Because at Christmas, we have the presents, we have cards, lots of festivities. There's a Christmas dinner, Christmas parties, Christmas trees, Christmas lights, Christmas shopping, Christmas holidays, family meetings, everything. Everybody seems to go mad at Christmas. Obviously, it's been a little bit different this year with COVID, but nevertheless, Christmas of the Christian calendar seems to be the most important one. And I think possibly that may well be right, because it was the birth of our Lord Jesus. You know, the birth of any baby is a massive celebration, but the birth of God's Son is exceptional. And that's why it's so important to us. But why isn't Easter Sunday as popular or as important to the wider world as Christmas Day? Sure, we have Easter cards, we have Easter eggs, hot cross buns, but the celebrations are nowhere near as great as Christmas. It's usually the start of the good weather, which is something to celebrate. It's a time when we'll have holidays from school, and the holiday season starts. Jesus rose from the dead on Easter Sunday. What could be better than that? What could possibly be greater than that? You know, it's a day of hope, Easter Sunday is. It's a completion of Jesus' work and his mission on earth. So why isn't that the most important? Again, what about Good Friday? Perhaps Good Friday should be the most important, because that is when we remember our Lord Jesus being crucified, which was the focal point of his mission, the greatest act of love ever, when the Lord Jesus gave his life to save us. Which one would I choose out of these three? Which one would you choose? And after saying that, all that, I think it's a bit of nonsense, because it's a bit like saying, which is the most important, your heart, your brain, or your lungs? Because they all fit together. You know, they are all different events, but they're all super important, but they all fit together. And there's no one without the other. Let's click on to the next slide. Okay, Christmas. God sent his son, he was revealed to the world, revealed to the shepherds and the wise men. God gave his greatest that he had to give, his one and only son. And you know, it's the start of God's plan of salvation. This is why it's fantastic to celebrate it. If you remember, just before Christmas, we went through Advent. When we prepare for the coming of our Lord Jesus. And we went through the candles, the peace, the joy, the love, and the hope, celebrating the gift of Christmas. It's a remarkable event. Every date that we use is based on the Christmas calendar. It's based on the birth of our Lord Jesus. Everybody loves the birth of a baby. It's a really joyful occasion. And it was the fulfillment of the promises of the Old Testament. It's the start of God's plan of salvation. The most important thing about it is that Jesus became fully human. And he was born as a baby, the same as us. You know, if Jesus wasn't God's perfect and precious son, he wouldn't be able to save us. But if he didn't become human, he wouldn't have been able to die on the cross to take the punishment for our sins. Good Friday. You know, even since for a child, I've always thought, why is Good Friday called Good Friday? Clearly, it doesn't feel like it was good for Jesus. Nothing was good in the way that our Lord Jesus was treated. You know, it wouldn't feel wrong to have called it Terrible Friday. You know, we remember how our Lord Jesus was so badly treated. We remember how he was flogged and spit at and abused. He wore a crown of thorns and was made fun of. But he didn't protest or complain, because that was his mission. Our Lord Jesus, he came for our sake. And you know, on Good Friday, we celebrate our Lord Jesus' death, the suffering that he went through, and the punishment for our sins. And in it, we can see the love of God and the sacrifice. You know, it was at the cross where Jesus paid for our sins. It says in Romans that the wages of sin is death. And we often sing this hymn, "There is a green hill." There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gates of heaven and let us in. We may not know, we cannot tell what pains he had to bear, but we believe it was for us he hung and suffered there. Just before we pass on to Easter Sunday, the resurrection, we're going to look at that in a little bit more detail. But we're going to have a reading as we come towards the time of communion together. The reading's taken from Mark chapter 15. verse 25 to 39, and it talks about the time of our Lord Jesus' crucifixion. It was 9 a.m. when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. And they said, "If you're the King of the Jews, save yourself." Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So you were going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then some of those standing near heard this. They said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Then someone filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down." With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Now that's a difficult reading, isn't it? A difficult reading of our Lord Jesus and what he went through for our sake. You know, he didn't have to do that. He didn't have to die on the cross of Calvary. But he did it for our sake. He did it for our sake. You know, we've been talking about Christmas, Christmas Day, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. These are the days that we celebrate in the Christian calendar. But, you know, Jesus didn't ask us to celebrate his birth, nor to celebrate his resurrection, you know, Easter Sunday. But he does ask us to remember his death, which he went through on Good Friday. The Last Supper says that Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." You know, we rightly remember Christmas once a year and Easter Sunday once a year. But the remembrance of our Lord Jesus is every other week. We're going to have a hymn now. Before we break bread, "When I survey the wondrous cross." You know, the words are so poignant, aren't they? "See from his head, his hands and feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Were the whole realms of nature mine, that were a present far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Let's listen to the hymn.
"When I survey the wondrous cross on which the I can't.
Lord and Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning and we remember you. We remember your sacrifice. Your sacrifice on that cross of Calvary, where you went of your own free will for our sake. We thank you that nothing was held back, that you gave your life, you gave your all for our sake. And Lord, as we take this bread, we remember the extent of your love. We remember all that you gave for us. And we thank you, Lord. Amen. And take the bread together. Lord, we thank you for the fact that you shed your blood. Lord, we think as in the hymn, how that see from head, hands and feet, how sorrow and love flowed mingled down. Lord, your blood was shed for us in sorrow and in love. Lord, we thank you for this. We know that there's no other way that our salvation could be met. Lord, that you became our substitute on the cross. You hung there for our sins and you gave your life for the things that we do wrong. And Lord, we thank you for this. And Lord, as we take this wine, and Lord, as we drink it, we remember how that you gave your life for each one of us. Amen. Okay, let's move on to the resurrection. How important is the resurrection? What does it mean to us? You know, if there was no resurrection, would our sins still be forgiven? Could Jesus' mission have been accomplished without the resurrection? Does it have anything to do with us? Or was it God saving his son after he'd saved us? We're going to have a reading now. I'm going to read it. And if you just hold the line a second. Sorry about that. There's lots of noise from upstairs. I was just going to sort it out. Okay, let's have a look at the reading. This is about the resurrection. How important is the resurrection? How important is Good Friday to us as Christians? And the reading's taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12 to 19. If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ hasn't been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. What if Christ wasn't raised from the dead? What would be the effect of it? There are five things that I just want us to quickly go through. The five things. What if Jesus wasn't raised? What would it be like? What would happen? The first thing is our faith would be futile. You know, the central truth of the Christian life is that is our Lord Jesus. And our Lord Jesus, he said that he was going to lay down his life and he'd be resurrected again. He predicted that he would come back to life. And you know, if Jesus wasn't resurrected, it would have made him a liar. Just let me give you an example of where he said it. This is when he was speaking to his disciples before they were going up to Jerusalem, where Lord Jesus to be tried and crucified. It's from Matthew chapter 20, and it says this: "Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death, and will hand him over to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and crucify him. And then on the third day, he will be raised up." It's a fundamental part of our Lord Jesus' mission. It's a fundamental part. It says about the disciples, that after Lord Jesus had gone back to heaven, Peter and John were preaching to the Jewish leaders and the captain of the temple guard. It says about them that they were greatly disturbed because the apostles teaching the people, proclaiming Jesus in the resurrection of the dead. The reason that the temple guard was disturbed about it was because they knew that Jesus had died. They'd seen him die on the cross. There was no dispute about that. But the fact that he'd risen from the dead proved that he was God. And you know, they couldn't stand it. That's what disturbed them. And that's what our faith is based upon. And that's why it's so important. You know, it's in the Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says this: "Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried and he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. That he appeared to Cephas and then to 12. And after that, he appeared to more than 500 other brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me." You know, there were so many people that had seen the Lord Jesus alive after the crucifixion, and they testified to it. All these people. There was the 12, there was Cephas, 500 other people, and also, last of all, to Paul. You know, if there hadn't been a resurrection, it would be a complete lie. You know, the resurrection is important to us. It demonstrates our Lord Jesus' power over death and that sins have been forgiven. You know, if there was no resurrection, how would we know that Jesus' sacrifice was sufficient? You know, when he rose from the dead, it proved that he conquered death and that we can know victory through our Lord Jesus suffering on that cross of Calvary. You know, when I was at junior school, I went to Chad Park. And we used to have assembly every single morning. We used to have assembly and all gather in the main hall. And the headmaster would stand there and we'd have a couple of hymns and he'd give us a short message. But on the table at the front, there was a wooden cross. And Mr. Sanford, the headmaster, often used to point to the cross. And he used to say, "Oh, we've got a wooden cross here." He said, "In some place, sometimes you see a man on the cross, sometimes a figure of Jesus nailed to the cross." He says, "But we don't have it here at school," he says, "because the Lord Jesus has been risen from the dead. He's not still on the cross. He's alive. And you know, that was a fantastic message. The cross is empty. The grave is empty. Our Lord Jesus has risen from the dead. You know, those that have died in the faith, those that have become Christians and passed away, we believe that they've gone to heaven. And that's the great hope that we have. You see, Jesus said that he's preparing a place for us. And when we die, it's a place that we'll go to. And it's a place that others have gone to before us. I've heard people saying that, you know, when we go to heaven, it's going to be fantastic. We're going to meet the Lord Jesus. We're going to meet God. We're going to meet the people in the Old Testament. And I've heard people say that, oh, we're looking forward to speaking to Moses and to talk to Noah and so on. And, you know, for me, it's great to be fantastic to see the Lord Jesus. But I'm not interested in seeing Noah and Abraham. I want to see my mum and my grandma because I know they're there. And that'll be great, won't it? We'll all be resurrected together and we'll be together with those that have passed on before us. Finally, if there is no resurrection, this life has no hope, does it? If there's no resurrection, the point of life would just be to live and to die. Our whole life will be based on survival. What would be the hope? What would be the point of living today if there was no celebration of eternal life? You know, the resurrection of Jesus is a central truth in our Christian faith, and it's what we look forward to. Without it, there is no Christian faith. Our last hymn is going to be "Because He Lives." Because He lives, I can face the future. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because He lives, it's because I know He holds the future and life is worth the living because He lives. That's what our faith is based on. Our Lord Jesus, because He lives, the risen Lord, and that's what we can celebrate. At Easter, we're reminded of the love of the Lord Jesus who gave His life that we might live. And we celebrate the resurrection as a promise of eternal life with Him. Let's listen to this final hymn.
Because He lives, I can feel.
Let's pray. Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love to each one of us. You love this world so much that you gave your one and only Son, that we might be called your children. Lord, we pray that we'll live in the joy and the hope of this Easter Sunday, every day. Lord, let us be thankful for your sacrifice. And as we remember your mercy and your grace to each one of us, Lord, we pray that we'll rejoice in our salvation, thanking you for what you've done for us and what you've achieved so that we might live. Lord, we pray that we'll live victorious Christian lives. Lord, that we pray that you'll forgive us when we do wrong. But Lord, we pray that our lives will bring glory and honour to you. Amen.
Some wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. That God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.